Okay, so we're going to look at decoding binary PCH codes. Okay, so that's our topic for the day. And the setup goes something like this. So you have a message M, which gets encoded by a P error correcting BCH code. You get a code word C, to which error vector gets added by the channel, and you get a receive vector R. Okay, so our first step is to compute syndrome SI equals R evaluated at R evaluated at beta power I, and this I do for I equals 1 to 2 times t. Okay, so I have 2 t syndromes, and I want to process these 2 t syndromes smartly to figure out locations of the errors. And like I said, if you want to do maximum likelihood decoding, you're not going to be able to do it. It's very hard. There are too many things to look at. So we want to fix ourselves to bounded distance decoding. So to that effect, we assume that E of x is of this form, right? So x star I1 plus x star I2, so on to x star IW, and W is plus 1 or equal to T. So this is our bounded distance assumption. Once you make a bounded distance assumption, it turns out the syndromes can be written as follows: x1 plus x2 plus xw. S2 can be written as x1 squared plus x2 squared plus so on till xw squared. Now all the way down to s2t becomes x1 power 2t plus x2 power 2t so on till xw power 2t. And what are these x1, xw, so on? Xi is basically xj is basically what? Beta power I j. Okay, so this is for j equals. Is that okay? And what is beta? Beta is an element of g of 2 power m. Order is greater than n. N is your block length of the PCH code. All those things are as before. Okay, we're not going to change that. Is that okay? So the question is, given the left hand side of these equations, given the s1 to s2t, how do you find x1 through xw? Okay, once you find x1 through xw, your problem is solved. Okay, so you know x1 through xw as beta power something, and this gate gives you the location of the error. Okay, that gives you the location of the error. You go there and flip it. Right, now this xj's also have a name. They are called error locators. Okay, so just to refer to them conveniently in the text, they are called error locators. Okay, so they are elements of the field G of 2 power m. They are not the locations directly, but if you write them as beta power something, that power gives you the location of the error. Okay, alright. So like I said, we are going to be substituting something here to get the to linear equations. Okay, so we have non-linear equations. We want to make it linear. For that, we're going to make a substitution, and the substitution is a bit of a fancy substitution. So what we'll do is, we'll define something called the error locator polynomial. Okay. Sigma of x, small x here, this is going to be 1 plus one x over there to 1 plus x to 2 x. Okay. So this is our crucial substitution here. Okay, so notice these x1 through xw's are my unknowns, right? I'm going to make a substitution. Okay, so I'll tell you what the substitution is. So sigma of x is a polynomial, and what will be the degree of sigma of x? What will be the degree? W. See, and the constant term will be 1. Okay, so suppose we write sigma of x as 1 plus sigma 1x plus sigma 2x squared all the way to sigma w x power w small x. Right, it's a degree w polynomial. This is equal to the same way 1 plus x1 x. Okay, so my substitution will take me from the set of variables x1 through xw to the set of variables sigma 1 sigma w. Okay, so I have a set of equations which are in terms of the x's, right, capital x1 to xw, the error locators. Okay, so these are my error locators. I have equations for my error locators and those are non-linear and I don't like solving them too much. Okay, not directly. On the left hand side here I have coefficients of error locator polynomial. Okay, and like I told you before, these error locator polynomials will be symmetric functions of the x1 through xw. Okay, so you can write it down without too much trouble. So for instance, if you want a literal translation here, what will be sigma w? If you want to literally write down everything, what will be sigma w? X1, x2, all the way down to xw. Okay, so for instance, anything else you want to write down. So for instance, if it's sigma 1, what will be sigma 1? What is sigma 1? X1 plus x2 plus so on till xw. Is that right? Okay, so likewise, if you can write, for instance, sigma 2 will be what? X1, x2 plus x2, x3, all possible, x1, x3, so on. So, all possible xw minus 1, xw. Okay, so all possible kind of product of two variables at a time, sum of all of them. Okay, so that's how it will be. So, you can write it down explicitly. And like I said, the sigmas are what are called symmetric polynomials in the x1 through xw. Okay, and any other symmetric polynomial in x1 through xw can be written in terms of sigma 1 through sigma w with some linear coefficients. Okay, so that is the crucial idea and that's what we will use here. Okay, so I'll prove it to you in some other way also. But let me ask you one more question. Suppose I do this substitution. I go from the error locators capital X's to my coefficients sigmas. Okay, sigma 1 through sigma w. Okay, I do that. Suppose I do that, then suppose I get some linear equations and suppose I solve for sigma 1 through sigma w. Okay, somebody somehow solve for the sigma 1 through sigma w. How do I go back to the capital X? Yes, I should be able to go back, right? So in one way it seems like I can do some polynomial multiplication and somehow figure it out. But suppose after I do this, I solve for the sigma 1 through sigma w. How do I go back to x1 to xw? Yeah, so there are the roots. Okay, so that is what is important to know. Okay, the roots of the error locator polynomial are what? X1 inverse, x2 inverse, so on to xw inverse. Okay, so if given the sigmas, you have to go back to the x's. What do? You go to your GF2 parent field. Okay, find in that field all roots of sigma of x and then take their inverses. You will go back to the x1 to x2. The roots are x1 inverse, x2 inverse, on to xw inverse. So you find the roots of sigma of x in GF2 param. That is also important. Okay, so it cannot be in any other field. In GF2 param, you find the roots and then take the inverses. Okay, so we have a substitution and we know how to go from one to the other. Okay, there's no problem. This is a proper one-to-one kind of substitution. You can go from x's to the sigmas. You can also go from sigmas back to the x's. It's no problem. Okay, alright, this is clear. So now I'm going to affect this substitution in this set of equations. Okay, so I want to put in the substitution in this equation and so some equations are easy. Okay, so for instance, S1 I can write as equal to what? Sigma 1, right? And you might be able to figure out how S2 also works. It's not too hard. Okay, so for some small numbers it's easy because reason is x1 plus x omega squared is simply S2, so S2 will be S1 squared, the sigma 1 squared. You can also do S3 with some work, okay? So S3 is also not very hard, but then how to generally do it is not very obvious here, okay? So what happens as this T increases, okay? It's not very clear what we do with those things, okay? So for that, I'm going to use a little trick to show you how this works. This is not the most general thing possible, but it's a useful little trick that gives you the picture immediately, okay? So what I'm going to do is the following. I'm going to define something that I call the syndrome polynomial. Okay, so there will be a lot of polynomials to keep track of here. So this is basically a very simple definition. I'm going to say it's S1x plus S2x bar plus S3x bar 3 plus 4 S2t x bar 2. Okay, so this is going to be my syndrome polynomial. Okay, so it's on the face of it, it seems like something is really ridiculous. We don't really care about it. We just put S1 with some polynomials and we put some coefficients there. Okay, so let's expand it. Okay, so let's see what we can do. Okay, so if I expand it, I'm going to get what? S1 is what? X1 plus X2 to XW, right? So if I do that, I'll get this. I'll write it a little bit differently. Well, okay, what is S2? What is X2? X1 x squared plus x1 square x squared, x2 square x squared, x3 square x squared. Is it right? Is that fine? Did I get it right? All the way down to x2 t squared x squared. Right? So S2 times x squared. And S3 times x power 3. So I'm going to say S3. S3 x1 power 3, sorry, x power 3 plus x2 power 3, x power 3 plus x2, x3 power 3, x power 3, all the way down to x2t power 3, x power 3, right? So now let me just put that and sum it out. X2t, make the same mistake again and again. So it's x1 power 2t, x power 2t, all the way down to x2 power 2t, x power 2t, all the way down to x3 power 2t, x power 2t. Plus x2t power 2t, x power 2t. Is that okay? Last row should be? Oh, W! Oh my goodness, you are right. I don't know why I went all the way down to 2T. You are right. Right, but the power goes all the way up to 2. Right? Okay, so I've written it up in this very painful form. The nice thing about this form is that it will give you a relationship between S, the coefficients of S and the coefficients of sigma. Okay, that comes from the following observation. It's a tricky little observation. There's no real reason why it should work this way. So what you do is, you take S of x in this form and multiply by sigma of x. Okay, and you observe something about the coefficient of the resulting polynomials. Okay, so that is the important point here. So let's see. Let me write down what sigma of x is. Take S of x in this form and then multiply it by sigma of x. So what sigma of x? Let me write it in this form. Let me throw a little challenge at you and see if you can observe something nice about this form, which will give some simplification. Okay. So this is my sigma of x. I'm going to take S of x and multiply by this polynomial. S of x in this big nasty form here. I'm going to multiply by each of these things. And I'm going to say I'll observe some very useful property of the product. Okay, and that will give me some nice equations involving the coefficients of S and coefficients of sigma. Specifically, I will observe that in S of x times sigma of x, some coefficients will be zero. Powers of some x bar somethings will always be zero. Okay, so once I make that observation, on the left hand side, what is the coefficient of any power of x? It will be some si sigma j kind of thing. So that's just linear expressions in sigma. On the right hand side, if I say zero, then I get useful equations which I can use to solve. Okay, so now I want you to stare at this for a while and tell me why a lot of cancellation will occur in this product. There are two terms. Yeah, see, so if you notice, look at the first row here. Okay, so look at the first row here. What happens when I multiply the first row with that way alone? 1 plus x1x. Okay, only with 1 plus x1x. Okay. What happens when I multiply something like this? I will have some x1x. Okay, after that, what will happen? The next power I will have will be x1 2t plus 1 x power 2t plus 1. Okay, right, so everything else will get washed out in that product. Then after that, I also have to multiply with these things. But what is the maximum degree of these things? W minus 1. So at best, it will only introduce factors up to W. Okay, so from x power W plus 1 all the way to x power 2t, I will have no terms occurring because of the first row. You see that? You do this multiplication. You first do a multiplication by 1 plus x1x. Okay, so if you do that, you will get x1x, and then the next term will be x1 power 2t plus 1, x power 2t plus 1. Okay, and then I multiply by all the remaining things. But that degree is only x power w minus 1. So at best, it will give you terms from x all the way to x power w. Okay, so from x power w plus 1 all the way to x power 2t, I will never have any terms in the first row product. Okay, now what will I do with the second row? So you start with the 1 plus x2x. First multiply the 1 plus x2x, and you have the same effect as the first row. Okay, so now I do this row after row after row, and finally conclude very easily that in SFX and sigma of x, the coefficients of x power w plus 1 all the way to x power 2t are 0. Okay, so that is the crucial observation here, and that gives us very nice linear equations. Okay, so of course there is very general theory called Newton's identities and symmetric polynomials which will anyway give these equations, but in this simple case we can easily derive those Newton's identities also. In fact, this is a way of deriving it. It's not very hard to do. Is it okay? So let me write that statement more precisely. Okay, so we'll observe. Okay, I'm not going to go into too many details here. If you want, you can try multiplying it out. In SFX times sigma of x, coefficients of x power w plus 1 to x power 2t are 0. Okay, so that is the crucial observation here. Okay, so now let's try and write it down. So S of x is what? S1x plus S2x squared all the way to, let me write also 3, S3x power 3 plus all the way back to S2t minus 1, x power 2t minus 1. The reason why I am writing all these terms is it just help us visualize and write down the correct thing that you want. Times sigma, which is 1 plus sigma 1 x, sigma 2 x square, sigma 3 x power 3, all the way down to sigma w minus 1, x power w minus 1, plus sigma w x power. Okay, so this is the product. What is the coefficient of x power w plus 1? Sorry? Yeah, so you get these equations, right? So what do you get? S1 sigma w? Plus S2 sigma w minus 1 all the way down to, so S3 sigma w minus 2 all the way down to, that will be the last term. S w sigma 1 and then plus S w plus 1, and that has to be equal to 0. Is that okay? Is that clear? Okay. So one can write down more equations. What are the equations can we write? So you can try repeating this. X star w plus 2. What will happen to x star w plus 2? It's going to be S2 sigma w. Is that right? S3 sigma w minus 1. S4 sigma w minus 2. All the way down to, what will you have here? S w plus 1 sigma 1 plus S w plus 2 equals 0, right? So likewise, you can keep on building. So let's just for fun write x power 2 w. Yeah, so it will go all the way like this, right? So SW sigma W plus SW plus 1 sigma W minus 1 all the way down to, what will be the last term? Okay, so it all depends on which is greater, right? So for instance, W is less than T, so 2W will definitely be less than or equal to 2T. So I can always fit in within this, right? So it will be S2W minus 1 sigma 1 plus S2W equal to 0. Okay, you will get equations of this form. Okay, so how many equations I have here? W equations. And how many unknowns I have? W unknowns. Okay, right. So I have W equations and I have W unknowns. So let me write it down in a matrix form. Okay, and we'll start at the matrix and make some comments about what can happen. Is that okay? Is it clear? Okay, so what we are doing? Okay, so these are not the only identities, there are other useful identities, but these identities are useful as in they are very general. Later on when we see, we can use easily generalize. Okay, the reason why I stopped at 2W is because I have W equations. Okay, I want W unknowns, W equations, and that's very nice. Okay, so let's go through and write this in an equation form. Okay, so I'll make a lot of comments about implementation efficiency and all that later, but right now we just want a decoder which works. Okay, so let me write down in matrix form from AX equals B, right? So standard form for the linear equation. Okay, so on the right hand side I'm going to have SW plus 1, W plus 2 all the way down to S2W. Okay, that's what I have here. Okay, and on this side, okay, I want to have sigma W all the way down to sigma 1. I can have it in any order, but that's just a nicer order because then the equations come out very nicely. So I'll write sigma W minus 1 all the way down to sigma 1. And now I can write this, the rows very easily. So S1 through SW, S2 through SW plus 1 and so on. Okay, so that's the idea. W plus 1, am I right? Is it SW plus 1? No, SW, no? SW. Sorry. All the way down to S2W minus 1. Okay? Okay, so this is a set of linear equations which I can easily solve. So no big deal in solving it. Assuming what? When can I easily solve this equation? Yeah, if this is full rank, right? So don't, when you're just giving answers in terms of determinant, it's okay, but and this has full rank. Okay, so this matrix has full rank, or its determinant is not zero. I can uniquely invert this and find sigma 1 to sigma W and I'm done. Okay. But I have to now worry about when will the determinant of this matrix be non-zero. Okay. So one can do some computations and show if W is the actual number of errors that occurred, okay, then this matrix will actually have determinant non-zero. You can show that. Okay. You can also show more interesting things. If W prime is the actual number of errors that occurred, and if W is smaller than W prime, okay, I think you can show that the matrix will still have full rank, but if W is greater than W prime, the matrix will not have full rank. You can show such nice properties. Okay, so let me write that down. If W prime is the actual number of errors that occurred, so I'm not going to prove these things, there are ways to prove it, but I'm not going to prove it here. Actual number of errors, then I believe you can show, so I'm going to have to check this, but I think what you can show is if W less than or equal to W prime, rank is full. If W is greater than W prime, rank is determinant is 0. Let me just write it in. Okay, so there's a way to prove it. It's not very hard to prove. Once again, use the van 't Hoff kind of argument and write down S1 as W prime as the actual number of errors. You assume the errors occurred at some point. You write it as a sum. Then you can write this matrix as a product of some two or three different matrices, and then you can observe that each of them will be full rank if W is less than W prime. And when W becomes greater than W prime, two columns will repeat, and you'll see that it will not be again same van 't Hoff matrix kind of ideas. So you write this as a product of some two or three matrices. And do it. Okay, so it's not very illuminating, so I'm not going to write it. And these are also not the best equations possible. I'll come back to it later on. But anyway, for now, these are good enough. We can be happy about it. Is that okay? All right. So this is a set of linear equations. So what do we have now? So let me go back to this original picture that we had, and tell you where we are. So we are now able to solve for. Okay, so let me take this diagram and then try to complete it. Okay, let me try and complete it. So we went from the error locators as x1 through sigma of x, and then here we solve for sigma of x. Remember, in our solution, in our method of solution, we also are going to find the number of errors in a way. Okay, so we will also find the W and we'll also solve for sigma. How will we do that? Okay, so how do you use this information and find W? You start from W equals T. Okay, because anyway beyond T you're going to give up, and keep decreasing it till you get a full rank matrix. Okay, so when you come to a point where you have full rank, you invert and find. Okay, so it's a very simple method you can use to implement this. Okay, that's the idea. Okay. But remember, we are assuming less than t, and the number of errors can be greater than t. Okay, so if it's actually greater than t, some crazy thing will happen. I'll tell you what are the crazy things that can happen. Okay, so you solve for sigma of x. What's the next step after you solve for sigma of x? You have to go back to the error locators, right? So what do you do? Let's say degree is W. Okay, then what do? After you solve for sigma of x of degree W, find roots of GF2 par n. How do we do this? It's trial and error. You substitute one after the other in GF2 par n. It's not more than n in number, so you can just quickly do it. You compute it, you will find the roots. Now your problems can surface. Okay. So there are several branching out points here. There will be two points. In one side you can have failure. The other side you can have success. Okay, when will you have success? When there are exactly W distinct roots for sigma of x in GF2 par m, you have succeeded. Right? You're finding roots for sigma of x in GF2 par m. The sigma of x has degree W. It will have at most W roots, but it can have any number of roots from any field. It can have repeating roots. All kinds of crazy things can happen for a general polynomial. When will you succeed? When there are W distinct roots for sigma of x. Why is that? As the way we wrote down the equations, we assume W is distinct roots, and then we assume W errors, and then we went and did the computation. If in our sigma of x we are not getting W distinct errors, something is wrong. Something else has happened, there have been too many errors, and our equations are not working out properly. Okay? So failure will happen in any other situation. Okay, so what is the situation in which you will have success? W distinct roots. Okay, and these W distinct roots I can call x1 inverse, x2 inverse, all the way to xw inverse. So those are the error locations. Once I know the error locators, you find, okay, find positions of errors. It's very easy, right? So you write, find whatever ij such that xj equals beta power ij. Right, so you go back and do that. So it's very easy. I mean, in fact, the root itself will come in the power notation, so you can quickly just look at it and find the ij's. Okay, so once you do that, what do? You take this r and then XOR it with the E cap. What is E cap? E cap is 0 everywhere else except at IJs. Okay, so E cap gives you the error locations. It's 0 everywhere else except at IJs. Okay, and this gives you your C cap. Okay, notice this failure is this new thing that happens in the bounded distance decoder. Okay, so in the maximum likelihood decoder, there's no question of failure. Always you find the closest code word. Here, when I can, I find the closest code word. When I cannot, I just give it. Say I can't do it. Okay, that's it. Is it okay? So what we're going to do next is look at some examples and try and write down these equations to see just how the linear equations look like. Okay, and like I said, there are a lot of much simpler equations involving the SS and the sigmas than the ones I wrote down. Okay, but the ones I wrote down are nice and consistent and complete in a way. The other ones are very smart. So this is not really the optimal implementation for this decoder. If you go and pick up any paper or a book, the implementation they'll talk about will be very different from this. Okay, the practical implementation, mostly what people do is a version of what's known as Bellingham's algorithm, which is an iterative way of doing it. It's a completely different algorithm from this. It will use very different kind of equations. It will not use these equations explicitly. Okay. The idea there is very simple, but not simple, it's very different. They use other kind of equations. So I'll point that out in the examples. Okay, so there's no point in doing that in theory because it's old stuff, it's in the paper, people have implemented it, every chip has it. So it's very commonplace, so I don't want to go through that in detail. But I'll take some examples. In the examples, I'll show you how that method will work. Okay, so just roughly, what those equations are, how do you think about it, how do you go about doing it. Okay. That's what we will do. But this is a nice method, as in this set of equations I talked about, they will generalize in a nice way even when you go to non-binary BCH codes. You see, when I go to non-binary codes, the same kind of equations will hold. See, that's the power of this method. So I don't have to redo this thing again for the non-binary stuff. Okay, so that's why I like this. But in practice, you don't want to do anything like this. So here, the solving for sigma of x, right? This is the critical step. Okay, anything else is not that complex. That's the critical step, and there are lots of algorithms to do it. Okay, Bellingham's algorithm is one. There's something called the Euclidean algorithm. There are so many variants of this, and we'll not see all of them. It's just time-consuming and not too illuminating. So we won't see that. But the other steps are quite straightforward and easy. Okay, so to illustrate this Bellingham's method and all, I'll take some examples. I'll try to show how that works. Okay, so let's so let me see how best to motivate that. Okay, so let's start with an example. Maybe we'll just see this method first and then we'll go to the other methods. Okay, for example. Okay, so we'll pick our favorite field, n equals 15, beta and g of 16, comma. Let's pick t equals 2 first. Okay, so just like that. The easiest possible test. So the zeros are okay. So t equals 2 is really easy. We know how to do it. We have another method with a quadratic equation, which is very nice. So let's pick 3 equals 3. Okay, so maybe just a little bit more non-trivial. So the zeros would be what? Beta squared, beta power 3, beta power 4, beta power 5, and beta power 6. Right? Those are the zeros. And then okay, so you're going to get okay, so let me try and describe this Bellicam kind of method to you very briefly. Okay, so I had this SFX and then I had a sigma of X. I multiplied it, and in the product I observed, okay, the product is basically there are some terms up to so let me just call it some T0 plus. T is a bad notation, so what can we use here? What notation can we use? Let's say alpha 0 plus alpha 1x plus 1 till. It's going to be all the way up to x bar w, right? And then you'll have whole bunch of zeros, and then you'll have terms greater than. So you have plus x bar 2t plus 1 and higher, right? Am I right? I'm sorry, alpha naught is? So there is something is there all the way up to here, and then beyond that you don't have anything. In fact, people also look at 1 plus s of x times sigma of x, so that also is used sometimes. In some cases that's useful, but anyway, it doesn't matter. So let's just keep it like this. Okay, so here you have something. Okay, so in a way what you want is in your decoder you want your w to be minimal, right? You want to find the smallest possible w. Okay, in our matrix method, we are starting with the largest possible w and then coming down and down and down. It's very inefficient if you think about it. You know, the smallest possible w is much more likely, so you should start with the smallest possible w. Okay, so if you want to start with the smallest possible w, people phrase the question, okay, so what they do is they first view this equation modulo x bar 2t, okay, or x bar 2t plus 1. So basically they just ignore all these things. Okay, I don't care about anything that happens beyond 2t. Okay, so I only worry about the first terms all the way up to let's say 2t. Okay, so first in 2t I have to make things 0 from w plus 1. I don't care about anything beyond that. Okay, and then the idea is to find least degree sigma of x that satisfies above equation. Okay, you find the sigma of x of least degree which will satisfy some property like this. So what do I mean by that? So sigma of x, remember, has degree w, and degree w x bar w plus 1 all the way down to all the way up to x bar 2t should be 0. Okay, so you find some sigma of x of smallest degree which will do this, then you are done. Okay, so you just start putting in sigma of x. You do it iterative. Okay, so first what you do is you find the sigma 1 of x, which is of let's say degree 1, that achieves that. Okay, and then you check what happens when you go to larger powers and all that. So you do it iteratively. Okay, so you start with this and then you move on to sigma 2, etc. Okay, and finally when you converge, finally it will be the correct answer. Okay, so this is the Bellicam kind of method, and it's a bit difficult to motivate and describe it. I can give you the algorithm. It's just like, you know, tell you what it's done one step after the other. You compute something and then you adjust for it. But there's no real depth, or at least I don't know in a way in which I can put down some general principles and derive it. Okay, so that's the problem there. But in implementation, it's very good. So some of you, if you're interested in doing a computer project instead of this too, you can take this up. You can implement Bellicam's algorithm. I think MATLAB already has an implementation, but you might want to implement it yourself. Okay, so you can try and implement Bellicam's algorithm for the general field. Okay. So you can try to do that step by step, and maybe present it in class so that people can figure out what it is. Okay, so if one of you are interested, I think some 2 or 3 people came and spoke to me about it. So this is one possibility. Okay, Bellicam's algorithm is quite nice. There are a few other algorithms, like I said, but this one is very nice. Okay, so but we didn't take this approach, right? So for us, the approach was something else. We are going to start with this. No, that's not how it's done. That's not how it's done. It's so, I mean, if I describe it, it will sound very weird. So if you notice, I want to do s of x, which is what, of 1x plus f 2x squared, right? And then I have sigma of x, which I know of 1 plus sigma 1x plus sigma 2x squared, right? But there are some very, very simple relationships. In fact, sigma 1, s 1 plus sigma 1 will be equal to 0. Okay, this you can see very easily. Okay, so sigma 1 and s 1 will be the same. Okay, so when you do the product, what happens in the first few terms? So let's look at the first few terms. If you look at the first few terms, you have s 1 x plus what? S 1 sigma 1 x squared. Then what is the x squared term? S 2 x squared. Okay, so I want the degree 1 sigma of x, which will make x squared 0. Right? If my weight is 1, w plus 1 should be 0. So how do I make, I will not care about the other things. I will only worry about how do I make w plus 1 0. So how do you make w plus 1 0? It's very easy. So remember, s2 is what? S1 squared. But it doesn't matter. So how do you make this 0? You set sigma 1 as s2 by s1. In which case, it's just equal to sigma 1. Okay, so like I said, this equation is a trivial equation, which can be very easily satisfied. Okay? So how do I find sigma 1 of x? I simply set it as 1 plus s 1 x. Okay. Now I have to see if this is good enough. Okay. So if this is good enough, what should happen? The degree 3 term should also go to 0. Okay. So I will assume sigma 1 of x is good enough and compute the degree 3 term in the product. I will see that it is non-zero. Suppose I see it is non-zero. Okay. Then I have to adjust the sigma 1 of x. How do I adjust for it? I will add another term or I will add something else. So the adjustment is a little bit complicated. I can't describe it very nicely. It's just painfully algorithmically complicated. That's all. You just make a small adjustment, you can drive it to zero. Okay, so that's how we do it. Okay, so it approaches it from this side as opposed to from the other side. But clear? Okay, so like I said, I mean, I don't want to go into too many details in the Bell-Lecompte algorithm. I mean, I'd be happy if somebody takes it up and then makes a presentation in class and also sees does an implementation. Okay, that would be a nice way of learning this stuff. This clear? So this is how you proceed. So you first start with this. And then you compute degree 3 term in s of x, sigma 1 of x. If it ends up being 0, well and good. You know? I mean, just 0, 0, 0, you don't have to do anything. If it is non-zero, then you have to adjust your sigma 1 of x. So maybe you have to go to a degree 2 term. So you do it step by step. At no point in time you try exhaustively all possibilities. That you never do. Okay, so it's just an adjustment based on the previous sigmas. So you can see, you can also show how it is done. Okay, yeah. Okay, so this method is quite nice. You can try to do it, but then like I said, it's difficult to prove its correctness and all that. I can't do anything else. But the other method is just straightforward. Okay, so let's take so we have about 5 minutes. So what I'm going to do is write down the general equations and then we'll see how it works. Okay, so what will be our method? So if you say t equals 3, first step is you have to assume like W errors happen. Then you write an equation, which is what? Which is the same equation, right? So let's just say 3 errors. Okay, so first assume W equals 3. First T is 3, right? You start with T equals 3, and your matrix is what? S1, S2, S3, S2, S3, S4, and then what? S3, is that correct? Does it go all the way to SW? Okay. S4, S5, right? And then your equation would be sigma 3, sigma 2, sigma 1 equals what? S4, S5, S6. Am I right? This is the equation. Okay, from S1 through S6, you already know, you computed it. So this is your equation. So write this down and then find the determinant of this case. If determinant is non-zero, that's it. You know already what you have to do. If determinant is zero, what do you do? You go to W equals 2. Okay. If determinant is non-zero, you are done. Done as in, I mean, you don't know if you're done or not. Done in finding sigma of x. Okay, you found sigma of x. If determinant is zero, you look at W equals 2. So if you put W equals 2, what matrix will you get? S1, S2. S2, S3, sigma 2, sigma 1 equals S3, S4. Okay? Again, you see if determinant is 0. Determinant is non-zero, you are done. If determinant is 0, then you assume a single error. Single error is very easy. You can do it in very different ways that you can also check. Okay? So, even the same method will give you. So, you put S1 times sigma 1 equals S2. So, we will set sigma 1 to be S2 by S1. Same method will work in this method. Okay? It's clear. So, if you want, you can take some numeric, specific examples and then simplify this. It's not very hard, but like I said, this is not the most efficient way of doing it. But it's a very easily provable method. The only thing I didn't show you was when this property of the rank, okay, if W prime errors actually occurred, W is less than or equal to W prime, determinant would be, W greater than W prime, determinant would be 0, W less than or equal to W prime, determinant would be non-zero. So the transition I didn't prove, except for that, everything else is easy to see. Okay? So, yeah, so I think for people who wanted a assignment for quiz 2, I would suggest Bellingham's algorithm. There's also one more algorithm called the Euclidean algorithm. Okay? So somebody can take a Bellingham's algorithm, somebody else can take a Euclidean algorithm for binary BCH codes. There are lots of simplifications. Okay, so you can try to implement it. Okay. So that's something you can meet me after this class maybe and we can discuss. Okay, so I think that's all I wanted to say about decoders for BCH codes. So this is a picture. And you have to keep this in mind, there is a syndrome computation and there is a root finding step. Okay, syndrome computation. And there's lots of simplification in each of these steps. So what do you do when you find syndromes is, remember R of X is a polynomial of degree n or n minus 1. Okay, n could be very large. Okay, and you don't want to evaluate it for so many steps. So what people usually do is when R of X comes in, they'll have a bank of dividers. Okay, and what will you divide by? What can you divide by? You can divide by something, some polynomials and get a very small degree polynomial and evaluate the syndrome with that. How can I do that? So suppose I want to find S1, which is R evaluated at beta. Okay, what can I divide R of X by to simplify my minimal polynomial of beta, right? So you take the minimal polynomial of beta and divide it by R of X. Okay, so you'll get a remainder. It's enough if you evaluate the put substitute beta into the remainder, right? Because the other stuff is going to go to zero anyway, minimal polynomial. So first step usually will be a bank of dividers with minimal polynomials. Okay, in fact, the first minimal polynomial divider remainder will also give you several other syndromes depending on your t, right? If your like t is 5 or something, for beta, beta square, beta power 4, everything you'll get those might be useful. They are useful sometimes. Okay, and then the next one is the beta power 3. You will again divide by the minimal polynomial of beta power 3, and then you might evaluate it only on the remainder. Okay, no point in evaluating it. So that way you can simplify your syndrome step a little bit. So root finding step, really there is no method. Okay, so you have to just substitute one thing after the other and check it. And that method is sometimes called chain search. Okay, so you might say, given that it has a name, you might think that it's a very smart way of searching, but actually it's just a substitution. Okay, you can't really do anything else. You have to substitute one after the other and check it out. Okay, and the critical step, like I said, is solving for sigma of x. Okay, so how quickly you can do it is critical, and this one roughly takes t square time. Okay, so t square operations. So these things will take something like t square only, but I think t square, I'm not wrong, it will be proportional to t, but this one is proportional to t square, if I'm not wrong. Okay, so I'll think about that. So this is a critical step, and how best you implement it will change a lot of performance. Okay. Now, like I said, nobody implements the method I just discussed fully. Okay, people who do Bellingham. In Bellingham, like I said, you don't try to find W and all, right? So you build it up. So some other method like that people use. Okay, so to just give you a flavor, I think, for instance, the DVB S2 standard, right? The Digital Video Broadcast S2 satellite communication standard. It has a BCH code, and I believe the length is 65536. Okay, so it's 535, I'm sorry. So your beta and all would be from GF2 power 16. Okay, so you'll have to do like two operations. I think this is correct. If I'm not wrong, I'll come back and change it tomorrow. But anyway, so this one is the field, and I think they use T equals 10, if I'm not wrong. So they use T equals 10. Okay. So you have to correct 10 errors in length. I'm not sure if n is 65536. Maybe n is actually less than this. Some other number, so it could be like some 56,000 or something. If it's something very large, and you have to correct 10 errors. Okay. So if you think about what you are accomplishing in this, if you think that this method and all is trivial, think about what you are accomplishing. How many error patterns are there with weight less than or equal to 10? If n is same, 65,536. Okay. 1 plus 65,535, choose 1, plus 65,535, choose 2, all the way down to 65,535, choose 10. How big is that? Okay. So you add up all that, you'll get a huge number. Okay. In this method, what you're actually doing is you're considering every single error vector in that list and finding which one was it that actually happened. Okay. So it's quite a non-trivial operation, and in terms of scale, it's very, very big. Okay, so it's not a very small trigger. It looks like some writing down some equations and doing some very simple things, but when you do it, it's quite impressive. So I think if somebody is taking up the implementation for BCH decoding, you should actually try it on this code. If you take like a GF2+16, in MATLAB, it's quite easy. MATLAB has the Galois field implementation. You don't care about speed and all that. You can actually show that when you add 10 errors, you can correct it. So that's quite a non-trivial algorithm that you're writing. Okay, all right. So we'll stop here. We'll meet again tomorrow.